Welcome to Passionate Reply, and welcome to Great Albums. Today, I'm going to be diving into a discussion of quite possibly the most derided and lambasted music group of the 1980s, A Flock of Seagulls. With a strange name, a perhaps painfully stylish aesthetic, and equally trendy and of-the-moment music that was for a time inescapable in popular culture, their legacy forms a perfect target for the ridicule all popular things must face in due time. But even more so than that, I think A Flock of Seagulls have become not only a punchline in and of themselves, but also a summation of everything that was dreadful or excessive about the early 1980s, with its second British invasion of synthesizer-driven new wave. I can think of no better example of this kind of abuse than a famous line from the 1999 comedy film Austin Powers: The Spy Who Shagged Me. The film is largely a love letter to the 1960s and its mod aesthetics, and the protagonist, a super spy unfrozen from this era in time, dismisses the history and culture of the 1970s and 80s as nothing more than, quote, a gas shortage and a flock of seagulls. But at the time of this writing, we're about as far away from Austin Powers as the film was from the release of this album, the band's 1982 debut LP. So I think it's been long enough that we can start to reevaluate A Flock of Seagulls' rightful place in music history. While this self-titled album was the group's first long player, their first release was the 1981 single It's Not Me Talking. Notably, this track was actually produced by the legendary Bill Nelson, who also released it on their behalf via his personal label, Cocteau Records. Ever since discovering this for myself, I've found the connection between Nelson and A Flock of Seagulls fascinating and also satisfying. Despite the gulf between their respective reputations, I do think their work has a lot in common at the end of the day. Swirling washes of synth disrupted by screaming guitars, not to mention that shared interest in mid-century rock and roll aesthetics. Two acts would, of course, go their separate ways shortly after, and they ended up in completely opposite camps, with Nelson becoming a cult favorite with little crossover success, and A Flock of Seagulls going on to create what is undoubtedly one of the most iconic songs of the entire decade. Does one even say about a song like I Ran? Over the years, it's certainly gotten somewhat overplayed, but I can't really hold that against it. It's just a damn good song. Both ethereally menacing as well as catchy and rather accessible, I Ran takes the atmosphere suggested by It's Not Me Talking and kicks it into another gear with a harder-hitting hook and the introduction of that highly distinctive and of the moment echoing guitar effect. Some will hear it as little more than evidence that the song is hopelessly dated, but I've never thought of it as anything other than satisfying to listen to. you ask me, I figure all art that exists is essentially a product of its time. Nobody ever said Michelangelo Buonarroti's David was a lousy sculpture just because you can easily tell it was made during the Italian Renaissance. At any rate, I'd encourage everyone listening to go back and listen to it again, trying to maintain a little neutrality. I'd recommend the album cut of it, which is significantly longer than the single version and features a rich intro that sets the scene before that famous guitar ever makes an appearance, which I think really adds to the experience. By some reckonings, A Flock of Seagulls are sometimes considered a one-hit wonder, but while they are certainly remembered chiefly for I Ran, this album's other singles were moderately successful as well. Space Age Love Song is perhaps the band's second best-remembered single, and takes their sound in a markedly different direction than that of I Ran. I Ran won popular acclaim by finding a new home for the guitar in the midst of a sea of synth, and pushed A Flock of Seagulls into a similar space as acts like The Cars and Duran Duran, who had enough mainstream rock sensibilities to sneak a lot of synthesizer usage onto American rock radio. Much as one might sneak spinach into tomato sauce when feeding picky children. But I think Space Age Love Song is much more palatable to listeners of pop, synth, or otherwise. It's softer in texture and really almost dreamy, capturing the hazy, buoyant feeling of Limerence as well as any pop song ever has. I'm tempted to compare it to another synth-driven classic whose influence towers over this period in electronic music, the great Giorgio Moroder's I Feel Love. Much like I Feel Love, Space Age Love Song combines simple, almost banal love lyrics with an evocative electronic soundscape, painting a picture of an enchanting, high-tech future where human feelings like love have remained comfortably recognizable across centuries or millennia. A similar theme of futuristic love pervades the album's second single, Modern Love is Automatic. While Space Age Love Song uses simplistic lyricism to portray the relatable universality of falling in love, Modern Love is Automatic gives us the album's most complex narrative. In a world where young love's forbidden, we meet a pair of star-crossed lovers prevented from being together by some sort of dystopian authority. The male member of this union, introduced as the Cosmic Man, is apparently imprisoned for the crime of loving, but the text suggests that he may escape from this prison, or perhaps even be freed from it. The title, repeated quite frequently throughout the track, is perhaps the mantra of this anti-love society, a piece of propaganda being drilled into us as thoroughly as it is into these subjects. Modern love is automatic, with no need for messy, unpredictable human input. It's also worth noting that the song is consciously set in old Japan, deliberately locating it in the exotic East. While East Asia was strongly associated with refined, perhaps futuristic culture, I can't help but think there's a more pejorative sentiment operating here, rooted in stereotypes of Asian cultures unduly policing sexual freedom and other forms of personal expression and self-determination. Ultimately, despite its futuristic trappings, Modern Love is Automatic isn't really a song about technology at all, but rather authoritarianism. Telecommunication, on the other hand, engages more directly with that theme. Communication was also released prior to the self-titled album proper and was also produced by Bill Nelson. While structurally similar to Modern Love is Automatic, with an oft-repeated title, brief verses, and a generally repetitive musical structure full of meandering guitar, its text quite plainly discusses the titular field of technology, in a seemingly non-judgmental fashion. Though it could be argued that the fairly upbeat music suggests a positive outlook on things like radio and TV. The one hitch in all of it is at the very end of the last verse, which sets the song in the nuclear age, a nod perhaps to the darker applications of 20th century technology. Telecommunication is perhaps indebted less to figures like Marauder and more so to Kraftwerk, who first solidified the rich tradition of stoic synth thumpers about everyday machines like cars, trains, and of course nuclear energy. I'm also tempted to compare it to an earlier work of Bill Nelson's group Bebop Deluxe, Electrical Language, another bubbly number that playfully bats this concept back and forth. The theme of quotidian technology is also present on the cover of this album, which features an interior shot of a living room centered around a television set. The TV displays a figure playing guitar, perhaps one of those heroic rock pioneers of the mid-century like Buddy Holly, whom Nelson was so keen to imitate. But what's most immediately striking about this cover is its beautiful color palette, full of deep, saturated jewel tones, treated softly with an airbrush-style effect. Despite being a somewhat mundane scene, the image also features fanciful, imaginative touches. The floor of this room is actually a miniature beach landscape, with the floor beneath the TV actually being the surface of the ocean. And the TV appears to be surrounded by a colorful, glowing group of birds. Given the beachy surroundings, we can perhaps interpret them as the titular seagulls. It's tempting to think of this scene as a representation of how technology can sweep us away, out of our everyday existence and into something richer and more exciting. But perhaps it's not so simple. Note also the open window in the top left, whose curtain appears to be agitated by some sort of motion in the air. Perhaps these birds are not the products of television fantasy, but rather have flown in from the window, and hence hail from the real world. Given how tracks like Space Age Love Song and Modern Love is Automatic tackle the theme of the mundane meeting the fantastical, I think this complex and arresting image is a great fit for the album. While their self-titled debut spawned multiple recognizable hits, A Flock of Seagulls never came anywhere close to recapturing its success. For the most part, they struggled to remain relevant as time wore on, largely abandoning the sonic footprint of their first album and chasing after new trends in music technology, such as digital synthesizers. They would eventually break up during the mid-1980s, and though they've reunited in order to perform live several times, the book is probably closed on A Flock of Seagulls. Personally, I can't help but wonder what might have been if they had stuck to their musical roots a bit more. You get a bit of that on their third LP, 1984, is The Story of a Young Heart, which thankfully brings back that iconic echoing guitar, and does so without sounding too much like a simple retread of I Ran. Out of all their other work, it's the album I would most recommend to admirers of this debut LP. My favorite track on A Flock of Seagulls' debut LP is Messages, not to be confused with the track of the same name by Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark. More so than anything else on the album, Messages has this aggressive, insistent, driving quality, and feels less like yacht rock and more like punk rock. Despite not being released as a single, I think it's a very strong track that's quite easy to get into. That's everything for today. Thanks for listening.